I'm Joel Kovel of the Institute for Media Analysis and Bard College, and I'll be moderating this panel on anti-communism in American intellectual life. A topic whose boundaries can probably not be drawn. So extensive is the influence of anti-communism on American intellectual life. But our panel will attempt to probe some of this hitherto hidden area, in my opinion hidden. Our first speaker will be Blanche Wiesen-Cook, professor of history at John Jay College at the City University of New York, author of many articles, very important work on the Eisenhower administration, exposing, among other things, the anti-communist policy therein. Blanche tells me that we are privileged to receive her first volume of her biography of Eleanor Roosevelt, which will be out in about a year, published by King Press, and that Blanche is also currently somewhat on leave, but basically intends to return to WBAI New York, where many of you probably have and can continue to hear her talking about rebels and dissenters. And I will now turn the microphone over to Blanche Wiesen-Cook.
Thank you. It's actually activists and agitators.
Oh, sorry.
I just want to say, looking around this splendid conference that the Institute for Media Analysis has blessed us with, I just feel very privileged to be here surrounded by so many courageous and important contributors to our history. I am an historian, and to our present moment of activists and agitators, and I really think this is a great moment of celebration. I don't usually sit down to speak, and if it's hard for me, I'm going to stand up and grab this microphone, but I'll try it. To think systematically about the impact of anti-communism on American life is to think about every aspect of American life. Every moment of our era has been touched and diminished by this crusade. While Democrats, reformers, progressives, visionaries, and revolutionaries fight over every issue, anti-communist crusaders are united by their purpose to maintain power and control absolutely and against all opposition. And this has been going on, as you know, forever. We can start with the 20th century, the Wobblies, the eight-hour day unionists, through all the populists and progressives and Democrats who became what McCarthy called the phony, egg-sucking liberals, commiecrats, and queers. Isn't that cute? Who he said dominated the New Deal. On to the crusaders for racial justice, peace, and decency. The women's movement, the movement for gay rights, for health care, for birth control, the movement against apartheid and against pesticides, all dominated by communists. Let's not forget, as the fish in our seas blister and bloat and the whales refuse to return home, that Rachel Carson was called a communist because she wanted to prevent a truly silent spring. Everything creative, fine, and imaginative in American thought has been splattered and soured by the anti-communist vitriol. Anti-communism has narrowed the American mind and has been responsible for the incredibly shrinking American heart. It has polluted the discourse, destroyed our national credibility, vitiated our democracy. After decades of red scares and red squads, of MK Ultra and COINTELPRO, of covert and overt operations and counterinsurgency capers on every continent, we stand morally isolated before the world, allied with South Africa, and other killer countries on the wrong side of every movement for human justice and national liberation, always bellowing when we are not shrieking and thumping and bumping and burping our guns and tanks and missiles, communist, communist, communist. And who are these communists? Presumably we were to know by their answers to these questions. Have you ever read Karl Marx? What do you think of Henry Wallace's third party movement? Have you ever had Negroes in your home? There is a suspicion in the record that you are in sympathy with the underprivileged. Is this true? Did you ever write a letter to the Red Cross about segregation of blood? That's a reference to the fact that blood was segregated even in the military after World War II. By the way, it was segregated white and colored and Christian and Hebrew. And it was segregated in Korea, and it didn't get integrated until 1958. So that's what that refers to. Have you ever read Tom Paine? Have you ever read Upton Sinclair? When you were in X's home, did X's wife dress conventionally when she received her guests? I've been privileged to write about several American heroes. Among the greatest women of America, all denounced as communists, all followed and hounded by the FBI, all assailed as un-American and dangerous. One of my first studies was of a woman called Crystal Eastman, a feminist, suffragist, labor lawyer, and socialist. She did one of America's first investigations of work accidents in the law, fought for safety in the workplace, and introduced the first workers' compensation law in 1909, which became the model for the United States' workers' compensation law in 1913. She founded during World War I the Woman's Peace Party, which became the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. And in 1917, as the director of the American Union Against Militarism, she founded something called the National Civil Liberties Bureau, which became the, are you ready, American Civil Liberties Union. The recently and much maligned ACLU, to protect civil liberties in wartime. In 1917, her magazine, Four Lights, the Journal of the Woman's Peace Party, hailed the Russian Revolution with mad, glad joy. After the war, she was hounded and harassed. She was a dedicated socialist and also a feminist. She was one of the four women who introduced the ERA in 1923, saying about the ERA, "This is a fight worth fighting, even if it takes 10 years." Then, virtually alone in her feminism and blacklisted for her socialist views and the fact that she and her brother Max Eastman co-owned and edited the radical journal The Liberator, which actually got the news of the revolutions out of Europe and into the already blockaded American press, she couldn't get a job and moved to England. Her life in exile was impoverished and unhappy, and she returned to the United States shortly before her death at the age of 47. In 1928. I first learned what Crystal Eastman looked like when she addressed large audiences. Her flamboyant manner, her reddened face when angry, her great tall presence, and her deep resonant voice. From the FBI files meticulously kept about her every public appearance from 1919 until her death. The long list of people, victims of anti-communist cruelty, who died prematurely and too young, of what are listed as ordinary causes rather than murder, is, as you all know, very long. And it all began in earnest in 1919 when the FBI began, to quote an FBI document, a vigorous and comprehensive investigation of anarchists and Bolshevists, remember Bolshevists, along with kindred agitators advocating change in the present form of government, and a librarian at the Librarian of Congress named John Edgar Hoover, was put in charge of that effort. They were into librarians in those days, and in 1922, the librarian for the Chemical Warfare Department of the Army was assigned, because she was a woman, to work with the FBI to collect all data concerning the various women's organizations throughout the United States, particularly those which are interested in disarmament. Lillian Wald, creator of the Henry Street Settlement in New York, the Visiting Home Nurse Service, the idea of public nursing and public health care, and Jane Addams were particularly suspect. Indeed, in 1935, the year of her death, Jane Addams was listed as a leading red, the most dangerous woman in America. But of this entire circle of reformist public women, Eleanor Roosevelt's FBI file is the largest, the most comprehensive, and the most complex. It tells us the most about what is un-American to the mean-spirited designers of America's political straitjacket. ER's FBI file is a running river of surveillance, mail checks, wiretaps, bed bugs, nastiness, and misinformation. The first entry is dated 15 February 1924, in case you all think you have long FBI files, aren't you, Shane? 1924. And it concerned her activities on behalf of Edward Bok's celebrated Peace Prize. Bok was the grandfather of the man who was president of this university. And his award committee was chaired by Esther Lape, Eleanor Roosevelt, and Narcissa Vanderlip. They were named in the New York Times when they were called to appear before Congress as dangerous internationalists eager to get America into that un-American body, the World Court, as two matrons of distinction and one young spinster. Esther Lape, who was chair of that prize committee, was actually older than Eleanor Roosevelt and Narcissa Vanderlip, who was the widow of Frank Vanderlip, the Secretary of the Treasury under a great Republican. You all know him well. But spinsters are always considered younger than matrons of distinction. The scope of Eleanor Roosevelt's file is a wondrous thing, involving gossip and hearsay, hate letters and threatening screeds. It is above all the FBI's selected edition of Eleanor Roosevelt's public writings. Practically every word she ever wrote, every word she ever spoke on behalf of international peace, social justice, rights of prisoners, racial integration, labor unions, victims of fascism, refugees from Hitler and from Spain. And it includes her criticisms of fascist-like practices, especially a criticism of the FBI and HUAC from Martin Dies' 1938 Committee to McCarthy's Demise. It includes her words on behalf of human rights at the United Nations and her efforts to negotiate with Russia, even when she is critical of Russia. Eleanor Roosevelt's own anti-communism was no protection against the spite of the splenetic Hoover, one she dared to criticize his excesses, which tells us something more about the impact of anti-communism on American life. Liberals might join the anti-communist crusade with gusto and gladness, or reluctantly and mildly. But the anti-communist crusaders make no such distinction. The fact is, liberals were and always were intended to be embraced by their dragnet. In 1936, Franklin Delano Roosevelt might want to blockade Spain, to woo rightist Dixiecrat voters. And he went so far as to ignore for six entire years, with nary a word of protest, all of Hitler's excesses. But the reactionaries ran a Hitlerite campaign. FDR and the entire New Deal was and remained their target. The Hearst press ran endless ditties in tone and theme familiar to us all. The Red New Deal with a Soviet seal endorsed by a Moscow hand. The strange result of an alien cult in a liberty-loving land. Or even more popular, a cartoon which featured Eleanor Roosevelt and Franklin Roosevelt dancing together, a little incomparable idea. And singing as they danced, "You kiss the niggers and I'll kiss the Jews, and we'll stay in the White House as long as we choose." After Kristallnacht, on 9 November 1938, Hitler was stunned by Anglo-American protest, however mild. He said over and over again, why, all I'm doing is killing communists and Jews. They are all hypocrites and liars. Given the 6-year refusal to allow more than a handful of Jewish refugees to enter the United States, and none at all to enter Canada on the grounds that they might be communists, and the fact that FDR appointed a fascist named Breckinridge Long, let's not forget Breckinridge Long, to head up the visa division and later promoted him to management of the State Department's entire European desk as late as 1939 after Poland was attacked. And the fact that the Second Front did not occur until 6 June 1944 and Lord Allenbrooke was head of the British Armed Forces, like the George Marshall of Britain, said in public, what we want to see is the Nazis and the Red Hordes battle it out so that we may preside over an exhausted Europe. Hitler's surprise may well have been well-founded, and so 40 million people were massacred, 6 million Jews, 20 million Russians, anti-fascist resistors, gypsies, gays, and all those that fit Hitler's social Darwinist category, lives that are not worth living. That's a very important category, lives that are not worth living. Now, 40 years later, we pause to ask who won, whose visions were victorious. There are today 38 million Americans who live in poverty, and 30 million of those are children. 80% of our $65 billion budget for science, research, and development goes to the military. And 3 million Americans are homeless. And while we are counting, that is the number of the people of Nicaragua. The population of the entire country of Nicaragua, 3 million people, is equal to the number of our homeless. Where we spend the money we no longer have and could never afford to kill and rape and plunder, we burn their new hospitals and community centers and schools with the money we need so desperately to build our own, and now we use the tragedy of this hurricane disaster as a weapon. How smarmy we seem before the world. And then there is the global carnage, the ongoing carnage, the unbelievable fact that 25,000 children die every day. Every day they die, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, of curable diseases, of malnutrition and measles and diarrhea. Between 9 and 14 million a year, a Holocaust by any count, all of them condemned to death by neglect, somehow an agreement made to ignore the post-colonial world's reality of Hitler's ongoing category, lives that are not worth living. And here we are, our language debased, our vision impaired, our understanding gnarled and deformed by the current masters of the twisted word. Our students confuse capitalism with democracy, socialism with poverty, and blame the victims for the Holocaust. While only the United States and South Africa of the industrialized countries deny their people any kind of national health care insurance, we observe the tragedies without care. Carelessly. We tell our people it is all for the best, the good are triumphant, read my lips. But the good are regrouping. We have still to retake and occupy the high ground, to speak truth to power. Having trounced the communists, they mock the liberals. This is a moment of great opportunity, great urgency. They wrap the child in an American flag. The media plays it blindly, and the public applauds mindlessly. We are regrouping, and this conference is a wonderful thing. The Institute for Media Analysis and all our allies, all of us here, are on the road to a new beginning. I just want to say a word about this past campaign and this new beginning, because there are so many movements out there, so many wonderful alternative presses, the Women's Press, the Guardian, the New Directions for Women, or people are here today in these times, CAIB, Covert Action Information Bulletin. And when these cabbage patch Democrats told Jesse Jackson to go hide, all the energy and enthusiasm and vision of this campaign went to smash. And we need to notice that, because all of the vision and the energy is on our side, and there really are more of us than there are of them, but we never have a chance to vote for our candidates. And that's what we have to do, and we are doing it, building rainbows and green parties all over this country, block by block, door to door, the old way, the way they did it in the 30s. And we need to make it clear as we go along knocking on doors and handing out our alternative media that that child is not protected by the mantle of the American flag. That child is wrapped in barbed wire. That child starves and dies. We need to feed that child and nurture and educate and stimulate and love that child. And we can and we will. This is our battlefield. We have chosen it, and we should enjoy the fight, the ongoing struggle. I want here today to give special thanks to two fighters who taught me a lot about the good fight. Jim Aronson, whose book, The Press and the Cold War, showed us all how much the words matter, the uses of words in psychological and political warfare, and whose vision of independent journalism, the power and integrity of independent journalism, means so much to us all. And Dorothy Healy, always an inspiration. Her presence on Radio Pacifica, sustaining so many of us, and who said one great spring day in Los Angeles, "I don't get ulcers. I never get ulcers. I give ulcers." Well, that's meant a lot to me over the years. And after all, to save one life is to save the whole world. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker, the man of whom that cliche needs no introduction can truly be used, especially in the Cambridge community, Professor Stephen Jay Gould.
This is the fact of room that I lecture in all the time, unfortunately standing up. In December of 1919, Franz Boas, the great anthropologist, wrote a little letter to the nation that seemed harmless enough. Basically, he said that several anthropologists during the previous World War had, on pretense of gaining scientific information, doing research, been able to get to places they might otherwise have not been able to voyage to, and had then passed on intelligence information. Boas went on to say that he could understand this perfectly well if those who had done so had been either soldiers, politicians, or businessmen, because those professions are rooted in duplicity. But insofar as science is supposed to manifest a spirit of pure objectivity, this was a heinous breaking of scientific principles. I think we would read that letter today as a somewhat naive evocation of an impossible scientific ideal. In any event, Charles Doolittle Walcott, who I regret to say in this context was the greatest paleontologist in America, that being my position as a paleontologist as well, but who was also probably the most powerful scientific administrator in America, head of the Smithsonian Institution, and one of the arch conservatives of American science. His archives are at the Smithsonian Institution, very complete. I found this interesting unpublished item there when I was doing research for another reason. Few months ago, Boas, Walcott took this letter of Boas's as an anchor to try and essentially drum Boas out of American science. He wrote the following letter to Nicholas Murray Butler, president of Columbia University, where, of course, Boas was teaching. And he writes, first of all, the position that Dr. Boas had in connection with the Smithsonian Institution was abolished, as it was specially created for him by Secretary Langley in 1901, that is my predecessor. In other words, Walcott just summarily abolished Boas's honorary position at the Smithsonian. He then goes on to say, the article published by Dr. Boas in The Nation of December 20th was of such a character that I did not consider a man holding such sentiments a proper person to have an official connection with the Smithsonian. I prefer to have 100% Americans and have no use personally or officially for the addle-minded Bolshevik type, whether it be Russian or German, Hebrew or Gentile. I realize that the fighting is over with Germany, but it has only begun with the elements that would spread distrust, internal conflict, and ultimate ruin to all that Americans have stood for. At the same time, Walcott wrote a whole series of letters to all his conservative colleagues in American science, getting a bunch of interesting reactions. Some were sensible enough to say, cool your heels, Charlie, it's all going to pass, it's no big deal. He got the following, however, from Michael Pupin, also at Columbia, who said, Boas attacks the United States for the purpose of defending Germany, and yet he is allowed to teach our youth and enjoys the honors of being a member of the National Academy of Sciences. This thought makes me long for the good old days of absolutism, when the means were always at hand for ridding oneself of such a nuisance as Franz Boas. Walcott heartily agreed and wrote back to Pupin, thanks for your letter of January 12th. It sums up the case of Boas in a very forcible and, to me, satisfactory manner. Walcott went on with this campaign, securing various condemnations for Boas, including the main one at the meeting of the American Anthropological Association held in this city over Christmas time, 1919. The following resolution was passed at Walcott's instigation, condemning not only Boas, but the 10 people who happened to vote on his side of that particular issue, including James McKean himself. It is further respectfully asked in the name of Americanism and against un-Americanism that Dr. Boas and also the 10 members of the American Anthropological Association, who by voting against this resolution thus supported him in his disloyalty, be excluded from participation in any service respecting which any question of loyalty to the United States government may properly be raised. Now, I cite that little story for three reasons. First of all, to point out that the purveyors of this form of anti-communism are not the Yahoos, whatever they are, against the cultured, but come from within what you might call higher scientific culture as well, and just as virulently. Secondly, which I need hardly mention anymore because our first speaker gave such an excellent presentation on that subject, namely that anti-communism, as you all know, is of course not a phenomenon of McCarthyism and post, but has a very long history, and that the episode post-World War I was probably the worst in terms of jingoism, the year of the resurgence of the Klan, of the height of lynching, the anti-immigration movement successful, the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti, of the most virulent period of anti-Semitism. I didn't know Ring Lardner was going to be on this panel, but I had here, unless because it's something his father was involved in. I just saw Eight Men Out, and it's funny how it was so pervasive, it gets into little areas like the Black Sox scandal of 1919. Kennesaw Mountain Landis was appointed first commissioner of baseball to clean up the mess that had arisen from the throwing of the 1919 World Series, the Chicago White Sox, and is shown so well in that film by John Sayles and in Elliot Asanov's book, Ring's father, of course, having been a major actor as a journalist and exposing all this, that Kennesaw Mountain Landis was appointed the first commissioner of baseball. Why? Because he was a toughie who had led some of the judicial efforts against communists during World War I, and that's made very clear. So, it just pervades into every area of American life. But that's not the main. The third and main reason, however, for telling this Boas story about C.D. Walcott is it really comes in the character of that first letter. If I can just reread one of its phrases where he says to Nicholas Murray Butler, I have no use for the addle-minded Bolshevik type, whether it be Russian or German, Hebrew or Gentile. I mean, that statement is so evocative of what the whole issue is, because all of Walcott's prejudices come pouring out. I mean, his anti-Semitism, his feelings against Germany, he'd lost a son in World War I, his anti-communism, it all gets pushed together. And I guess the main thing I want to say is that I don't mean to take anything away from the specifics of anti-communism per se in America. It haunted my own childhood, my family suffered, as did many of you. But what I do want to suggest, as I'm sure we all understand, is that anti-communism is really a metaphor, perhaps that's not the right phrase, rather it's the specific American expression of the saddest and most repressive generality about so many human cultures, namely that, unfortunately, power need not be imposed by force. The greatest tragedy is that the people themselves will often preserve a status quo that oppresses them if those in power can successfully scapegoat a group and therefore release the passions of irrationality against that group. After all, it is the nation's disgrace. Again, our first speaker said it so well, that a nation so wealthy, so, quote, advanced as ours, should have its frightening, disgraceful statistics on infant mortality, on the homeless, on health care, on the gap between rich and poor. That's our national shame. And it's in the name of anti-communism that that system has been able to be maintained, and that our voters and our people have not rebelled against it. I feel this keenly, since the topic here is intellectual life. It does have to do with the power of irrationality, especially as focused against groups who are scapegoated. The problem with irrationality, I think people see it the wrong way, as I'll get to in a moment, is that acts of irrationality can be so destructive and so immediate. It's the way they can undo years of geniality and goodwill in an instant. I remember when I visited Istanbul about 20 years ago, I learned, which I had not appreciated before, for example, that the Christian art, the great Christian art of Constantinople, was destroyed twice, but not by Muslims. Apparently, when the Muslims took over in the 15th century, they were so impressed by some of the great mosaic works that although they did cover them over, because they couldn't use those churches as mosques unless they covered over representations of human faces, but they plastered them over. They didn't destroy them. To this day, that plaster can be removed, and often is in many cases, to preserve the great mosaics. No, it was destroyed twice by Christians. Once by the iconoclastic movement, that's where we got the word, though it's a good word, perhaps the original movement wasn't, the 10th century iconoclastic movement of the icon breakers, and then secondly by the Fourth Crusaders, who having failed to take Jerusalem, decided they might turn their wrath upon the Eastern Christian Empire and marched into Istanbul and again destroyed it. If there's any symbol, of course, in the history of intellectual life, it's the destruction of the Library of Alexandria, in which in one moment, one day, more of the wisdom of the ancient world went up in flames permanently. So to me, that's the greatest tragedy. We're often told, particularly by folks on the other side of the political spectrum, that we really can't do much about this because it is in the nature of the genetic heritage of people to be nasty, to be aggressive, to be xenophobic, and that's why, all right, it's anti-communism in America, but you can't really help it. That's just a tendency of the people. And to me, that's such a nonsensical argument. The data of ordinary human behavior speaks so strongly against it. There is a tragedy. There's a great tragedy, but it's not the tragedy this is our ordinary everyday behavior. It isn't. But it seems so clear to me that our ordinary everyday behavior is geniality. The problem is that we don't catalog the ordinary acts of kindness. There's thousands of ordinary acts of kindness. We step aside to let someone pass. We say thank you to the man who sold us a newspaper. We smile at a child, but who catalogs them? I mean, human life couldn't go on without that kind of geniality. You couldn't live in any society without it. For any act of violence and aggression, there are thousands upon thousands of acts of ordinary kindness and geniality, whether it's on the streets or subways of New York or anyway. I mean, if you were an ethologist, someone trained to study animal behavior, and you cataloged hours of human behavior, and you set yourself up on Times Square in New York, what would you see? Maybe once every couple hours for the thousands of people you'd observed. You might see someone slapping a child. You might see a tough game of three-card Monty. I don't know. But for that, you'd see thousands of acts of ordinary geniality, even there. I mean, the species that we consider peaceful have been logged in nature for perhaps tens of hours with the observation of just a few acts of violence. And ordinary human behavior is much more genial. We're not a violent species, if that means anything. The problem isn't that. The problem is the kind of crushing asymmetry of effect. It's what one act of irrationality and violence can do to overwhelm the hundreds of thousands of uncatalogued acts. Larry, even though you're my son's teacher, don't flash it, please. That's the great tragedy. I mean, human behavior, as I see it, is an Everest of geniality. The problem is the mountain's inverted and it sits on its apex in one tiny little push. just knocks it over. You can have training programs in schools, as Larry and others do in Cambridge Orange and Latin, for years on anti-racist thoughts and literature. And it just takes one act of senseless violence that might happen to go across racial lines and the whole thing topples. Now, to me, that's the great tragedy. Irrationalism, though rare and unusual and not the normal behavior of human beings, is so easily unleashed and has such enormous power to overwhelm our ordinary behavior. I mean, it is that famous story of the movement. I don't know whether it ever happened. I suppose it did, of the communist rally that was broken up by policemen in Philadelphia, and one poor fellow just happened to be passing through, got caught up in it, and as the cop was beating him on the head, he said, "Stop, what are you doing? I'm an anti-communist." And the cop says, "I don't care what kind of communist you are." That's really what it is. Once you unleash the forces of irrationality, there's absolutely no turning back. That's the sadness. It's the great asymmetry. It's not the relative weight of the numbers of incidents. Now, what about solutions to this? I don't know any solutions to this. I could give the usual platitudes about education, respect for truth, the necessity of continual vigilance. Since I don't know any solutions, the best thing I can do is tell a story instead, and I end with that. It's a great scene in Brecht's play, Galileo, in which is a character called the little monk, who is a disciple of Galileo, a very good astronomer, knows perfectly well the Copernican system is true. Yet at one point, comes up to Galileo and tells him that he's going back to the church's belief in the Ptolemaic system, even though he knows it's false in some empirical sense, and he tells Galileo why. And the reason why he's going to do this, he says, think of my parents. They're poor people in the Campania. All their life they've struggled in poverty. They're grape growers. They have one spoon. They have one little cabinet of drawers. That's all they have. And the only thing that's supporting them ideologically, the only thing that's making that life tolerable, is the belief that they've been taught that everything in a stable universe has its right position in layers of subordination, and that just as the bishops are subordinate to the Pope and the people to the lords, so also is the sun and the moon subordinate to the earth. And if you break that, they have nothing but their poverty. And Galileo's wonderful response simply says to him, he says, I understand this, and he says, "I understand the divine patience of your people." He says, "But where is their divine wrath?"
In Ring Lardner Jr., our next speaker, we are doubly fortunate, first, to have an outstanding American artist and writer, particularly for the film, for the screen, in which profession he has won 2 Academy Awards. And second, and of course more pointedly to our concerns today, for someone who is both a victim of anti-communism in its most virulent form, and also someone who has set us an example of courage and refusing to yield to the pressures of conformism and betrayal. So it is with a special regard that I'd like to welcome Ring Lardner Jr. to this panel.
I assume I was invited here on the theory that a broad definition of American intellectual life would include the movie business. That was the business in which I worked from the mid-1930s to the 1980s with a 15-year hiatus from 1947 to 1962, during which I was blacklisted and could write for movies or television only through covert channels under pseudonyms. In 1936, in Hollywood, at the age of 21, I became a member of the Communist Party of the United States. And more or less at the same time, of so many other leftist liberal and anti-fascist organizations that I couldn't possibly remember them all now without the help of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, which it turned out developed later was keeping a much better record than I was of my activities. Many of us who came of age during the Depression had a very pessimistic view of the future of free enterprise, and it appears in retrospect a highly optimistic view of what could be accomplished under a socialist system. I think it's relevant to this discussion to mention that the changes we favored were basically economic, not political ones. The later post-war dichotomy of communism versus democracy never entered our minds. We thought that there were two different systems in the United States: constitutional republic and Russia as czarist empire, and naturally these two systems would have radically different means of affecting the transition from capitalism to socialism. A decade later, after the end of the war, we faced a whole new world in which the maintenance of peace in a nuclear era and later the preservation of the environment were issues that transcended the relative merits of the two economic systems. The immediate future demanded cooperative relations between the superpowers under a strong United Nations, and the ultimate hope was for some form of world government. Instead, we saw the startlingly rapid development of the Cold War and its American face, anti-communism. Under attack were any advocacy of harmonious American-Soviet ties and the reactivation of the trade union struggle, which had been subordinated to the war effort, and every kind of change in the status quo of American profit-making, class privilege, and race relations. In 1946, the Republican Party gained control of Congress for the first time since the 1929 crash, and the temporary Un-American Activities Committee was made a permanent body of the House of Representatives by a resolution introduced by Congressman John Rankin of Mississippi, an open anti-Semite and fanatical white supremacist. The revitalized committee announced that Hollywood would be a major target. Subpoenas were issued in September for hearings that were held in October of 1947. 19 of us who were called met and resolved that the most effective way of fighting the committee was to challenge its very right to probe into areas of free expression and free association protected by the First Amendment by not answering the questions, are you a member of the Screenwriters or the Screen Directors Guild? And are you now or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? We would be asking the courts to decide for the first time whether Congress had the right to ask these questions. The decision of the Supreme Court, after the death of two of its most liberal justices the summer before our case came up, and the appointment by Harry Truman of two conservative ones to replace them, was that the time was not appropriate to decide the issue one way or the other. Some years later, the Warren Court ruled in a similar case that we had been within our rights, but by that time 10 of us had served prison terms and hundreds more had been blacklisted. What was the committee's motive in going after the movies, and what effect did that investigation have? A partial motive was that there was more publicity in investigating Hollywood than in any other target they might have chosen first. But even more concern was the fact that the American movie business had begun in the late 1930s through the war years and the immediate post-war period to make a few pictures dealing with fascism, foreign and domestic, the plight of such underprivileged groups as the Dust Bowl Okies, the need for understanding among the first, second, and third worlds, and in a tentative, superficial fashion to deal with the explosive issue of race prejudice. As a result of a series of hearings lasting into the mid-50s, scores of those writers, directors, producers, and actors most likely to choose material with significant social content were banished from their professions. And that in itself diminished the whole medium. Also, the committee had told the studio heads to make anti-communist movies, and they obeyed the order. Though, like most officially prescribed propaganda, the films were crudely made and failed at the box office. The main effect of the repression was a general vapidity in film content, a reflection on the nation's movie screens of the intellectual doldrums of the 50s decade generally. Not until the new stirrings of social, political, and artistic awareness in the 60s and the arrival of imported samples from Italy, France, England, and other countries of movies whose form and content were departures from Hollywood orthodoxy did the American movie business begin to free itself not only from the self-imposed Roman Catholic-dominated sex and nudity censorship, but its equally self-imposed restrictions on social criticism of any sort. When we first went before that inquisition in 1947, we had considerable support, both from colleagues in Hollywood and from major American newspapers, law reviews, trade unions, and other large organizations. But by the time the court tabled our appeal in 1950, there had occurred, meanwhile, the Alger Hiss prosecution, the prosecutions of the Communist Party leaders and under the Smith Act, and the arrest of the Rosenbergs. There had also occurred, in the meanwhile, the emergence into the investigating act of a new figure, Senator McCarthy. Our Hollywood support disintegrated. Our own Screenwriters Guild passed a bylaw permitting the studios to deny screen credit to a non-cooperative witness before any of the committees. And the Motion Picture Academy passed a rule that any such witness was ineligible for its awards. Most shattering of all was the absence of significant protest from writers, artists, and other intellectuals throughout the land on what was happening to us and such successor victims as Lillian Hellman, Arthur Miller, and Dashiell Hammett. We had the wholehearted backing of Albert Einstein and Thomas Mann, men whose own experience enabled them to see what was happening in their adopted country. But what of the native-born intellectuals who had presumably learned American traditions in their childhood and had undergone what we used to call liberal education before the 1988 presidential campaign? Now the polls tell us that the majority of voters who do not call themselves conservative prefer the word moderate. And come to think of it, perhaps moderate education may be just the term to describe. what young people are getting today. Anyway, 35 years ago, there were, just for example, six then famous writers living who had already received or were soon to receive the Nobel Prize for Literature, and not one of those spoke out in defense of the freedom denied us. Not Pearl Buck or Sinclair Lewis or Eugene O'Neill or William Faulkner or Ernest Hemingway or John Steinbeck. That was part of the awful silence of the 1950s. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll now speak and then we'll have a discussion. We who have been working on this conference have been aware from the beginning that it is more than a gathering of scholars and activists to present their views on anti-communism and mostly to trash anti-communism. Not a good thing. Many people from the academy are here and we are in the heart of American academia. But our conference on anti-communism is anything but academic. We think we are not just reporting the history or structure of anti-communism, but also making some history as well. The very fact of having this conference at Harvard is somewhat historic. Imagine a conference on anti-communism at Harvard. What is the world coming to? Now, if you are looking at this point for news of the death of anti-communism, I'm afraid I have to disappoint you. The beast still lives in the person of George Bush. I think we have to prepare for some very grim and persecutory times ahead, despite his claim of instituting a kinder, gentler America. To say that anti-communism is the state religion of the United States, its established church, is not an empty metaphoric gesture. And yet, despite Bush, something in the structure of American politics has changed, and with this change, it is as if the clouds have parted a little. We have a moment to, an opportunity, and I hope we can use it well. Now, if we have a little space or opening within which to speak now, it is not due to any kindness or tolerance on the part of the system or its managers, but to the partial unraveling of a fabric of repression. If we can begin to look at anti-communism in the United States here, it is because the United States is weakening and has less capacity to enforce a megalomaniac ideology like anti-communism. And because also of profound and incalculable shifts in the Soviet Union, which have forced a change in the relations between superpowers. The golden age of anti-communism reflected the world order into which the American nation fell following World War II at the dawn of what is called the American century. It was a time unique in the history of capitalism when one nation controlled the world market and it was faced by one significant national adversary in some a bipolar world to suit a bipolar ideology, but also many other threats around the world, many workers' movements here, throughout Europe, possible communist takeovers in France, Italy, and so on, Greece, and perhaps more important than all, the rising of the ex-colonized peoples from around the world, all of which gave paranoia, the basic mechanism of anti-communists, its kernel in reality around which it could grow and flourish. The roots of anti-communism are buried deep in time, and the weed has flourished in one form or another. And the weed in one form or another has been present so long as capitalism faced adversaries, but it flourished most when capitalist power was concentrated in the hands of one violent, crusading, and single-vision nation, projecting outward militant power and professing at the same time democracy. The power, in some measure, is now diminished. And even though, due to anti-communism, the movements faced by American capitalism throughout the world have waned to some degree, it now may be said that we live in a multipolar rather than a bipolar world, more fluid and complex, and less suitable to the single-visioned Manichaeanism of classical anti-communism. And that, I think, is where our space for this conference has appeared, and where we now stand a little bit in the sunlight and can begin to look at things. To say that we can begin to look at things is to also say that we've been unable to look at things, or rather that the success of anti-communism can be measured by the degree to which it is accepted unquestioningly as natural and matter of fact. And therefore, the logic of our conference is not just to say that anti-communism is no good, but to actually open an inquiry, to create in the American mind, locally and then as far as we can reach, the sense that this is a deep problem in American life, a sense which has actually been absent from our national discourse. And indeed, despite the seeming transparency and reflexive nature of anti-communism, the ideology, in fact, is neither simple nor obvious, but a deep structure pervading our society and producing various offshoots at different points. For anti-communists come in all sizes. There are violent reactionary anti-communists like Oliver North and nice guy liberal anti-communists like Hubert Humphrey. There are gentleman anti-communists from Yale like George Bush, Nazi anti-communists in exile from Eastern Europe like Bush's anti-Semitic Committee on Minorities that we were asked to forget so quickly about during the election, and redneck anti-communists from the deep woods like the Ku Klux Klan. Some anti-communists are from the corporate elite out to secure their wealth from expropriated masses. Some anti-communists are trade unionists from the working classes. Other anti-communists are samurai, whose raison d'etre lies in heroic struggle against what they take to be the devil. Other anti-communists still are marginalized nativists seeking desperately to safeguard their identity against the intrusions of the modern state. Others are ex-communists in need, or radicals in need of finding a god to replace the god who failed them.